All right, well, let's continue. So I just want to emphasize again that this area, which is like 16,800 years, people actually could communicate without using words, that they understood each other on that deeper level, you know, completely. And that's why there was much less violence, that there was real attunement and also working with the earth, with the planets, with the cosmos. And then, like, the book The Fall by Steve Taylor was, I think, an important work. He found out that the violence and all that really began really after the Silver Age, you know. Started a little bit here, but that's when things really started going downhill. So The Fall by Steve Taylor talks about this fall from the nonviolence to violence. And he just looked through all the different, like, anthropology, ethnography, all these different studies done by scholars, and you go back and you find out, well, there was really no war before 4000 BC. And the thing is, I think there were wars, but not the kind that would leave any type of signs that we're used to looking at. And I'll mention a little bit of that later. Also, the other thing is, you know, people are living on fruit and light, and they don't need agriculture. In our histories, we think that agriculture was a step forward. You know, people now are starting to grow, you know, grain and all this stuff. And in reality, it was prior to that, things were a lot easier. And but because when the earth went downhill, you know, into the lower ages, more and more cataclysms, more and more lack of harmony between us and nature, it became harder and harder to sustain ourselves. And so that's when we started to have to depend on agriculture and moving into cities and things. And then eventually, of course, grains are used to make alcohol. You know, that's when things really started to go downhill, you could say, you know. I always wonder, like, how we have bars, you know, and nowadays, and you wonder, like, as you go into the higher ages, gradually, you know, the bars will disappear. Maybe not in Ireland, but, you know. But we'll see. And you have this change in the way we eat, you know. Remember, some of you have probably heard of Arnold Arendt, Mucusless Diet Healing System, and, you know, people living on sunlight, looking into the sun at dusk or at dawn, and feeding on the light, because after all, everything that feeds us from all the plants and everything comes from sunlight. And so if we understand that better, and if we understand the energy from the from oxygen, from the air and all that, we can start to live more on those kind of things. But everybody's a little different, and thought this one book, The Earth Was Flat, very interesting book where people were learning to be directly sustained by the sun, by sunlight. And I actually have a friend who's done that, and he had like a deep spiritual experience when we went to Hidden Valley for a retreat and a few years ago, and then he noticed he didn't need to eat anymore. And so after about 8 or 9 months of having basically needing nothing to eat and being the same weight, and then he noticed he didn't need to drink either. And so really the only thing he'd have is this little thing like this of a little bit like lemon juice with a tiny bit of honey, like this little thing, and that's all he'd have each day That's all he needed, and was perfectly happy, you know. And now he still eats when he's around people, because he gets that vibration of desire from people when it's lunchtime or something. Okay, then he have a little something to eat, but on his own he doesn't really need to eat, you know. And he just lives off the sunlight and air, you know. And so he's a close friend of mine, so I mean, I know it's true, you know. And very interesting. So looking at these ages, you know, coming down out of the Silver Age, hunters and gatherers needed 2.5 square miles per person to feed themselves, if you're just a hunter-gatherer. So like each person needs 2.5 square miles, you know, of wilderness to survive on. So, and hunters and gatherers only need about 3 hours per day of work, you know. Agriculture, we work really hard, you know. But these people only, you know, they had a pretty easy life as hunter-gatherers. And from the higher ages, you know, you're living off sunlight, you're living off like a few fruits and things. It's not a big deal. You know, we've lost that. We've forgotten that. The later cities with agriculture societies needed 80% to 90% farmers to sustain the 10% to 20% city dwellers. Now we only need like 2% people doing farming to sustain everybody else, you know. So it's another sign we're in a higher age. So I mentioned that about the agriculture comes alcohol, you know. I mean, the idea of bars where people sit in a building with no windows or sunlight and just drink to get intoxicated. It's just, I've never liked alcohol, you know, because it feels uncomfortable to me, because I feel the peace from meditation, and that feels natural to me. If I have a little bit of alcohol to drink, it feels unnatural, so I don't like it, you know, which is good. I'm glad of that, you know. That's why it does seem weird to me, you know, the bars, you know, but most people are very comfortable there, you know. And but it's because they've forgotten the deeper way to get in touch with spirit, and so this is kind of a counterfeit spirit, you know, and they call them spirits, right? You know? So it's interesting, you know, and I understand when you've been, you know, and you don't have that attunement, and you're living a very tough life, and people want to forget and just, you know, celebrate or just go out, you know. I understand that happens, you know, but if there's any way you can go deeper, you know, it's a lot better, you know. So, and also descending in the Silver Age, the Indus Valley Civilization, the largest of the ancient civilizations, 70 cities, some of which house as many as 50,000 inhabitants. And what's interesting, this is actually already in the beginning of Dwapara Yuga, because you didn't really need cities in the higher ages. Even though, I mean, Atlantis was, I guess, a city. They had some kind of things like that. But as I mentioned last time, as we went up in the ages, we realized we didn't have to be centrally located anymore, because everything we needed, we no longer needed infrastructure for sanitation, like all the pipes and all the, you know, because even now we're starting to get away from that, and we won't need it anymore. So no weapons were found there in the Indus Valley. No temples or houses of worship, because people were in tune within, and they didn't need to go places to, you know. It's kind of interesting, you know, because for us it's still important to go somewhere where there's the good vibrations. But if you're in that state all the time, it's different, you know, it's easier. And the Indus Valley civilization was in decline by 1500 BC. And in the Vimanika Shastra, they talk about the flying machines and the ability to travel, you know, space travel. And Vimanika Shastra goes into a lot of detail of even what the diet is for the pilots of the vehicles, and then there were a lot of interesting things in the Ramayana and Mahabharata where the people, like some of the kings, have flying machines and use them in war and things, and because things were getting more violent by Dwapara Yuga, you know, up here in the downgoing age, but they only had like one or two. They didn't know how to use it very well anymore. It's obvious that this was something from a higher age, and they were starting to forget how to use things properly. You know, it's like these spaceships or whatever they were would probably last 1,000 years before they finally broke down, because they used the energy of the air and whatever there was around. They had like, they didn't need the usual kind of fuel. Some of the later ones did, you know, that Vimanika Shastra talks about. But it's very interesting that it was evident in these texts that they were starting to, not real sure on what to do with them. And once they broke down, nobody knew how to fix it, because the last person was a mechanic for that might have died like 500 or 1,000 years before, you know. And so what do you do now, you know? And that's why I think we'll find some of that up on the moon or on Mars, you know. And then the Ramayana epic was at the end of Treta Yuga here. And he speaks of these mantric weapons, words of power for strength, freedom from food, and internalized supernatural weapons. I'll get into that. In fact, here it is from the Ramayana. Vishvamitra, the teacher of Lord Rama, taught Rama the mantras to summon the occult weapons. When Rama spoke the secret mantras, the lords of the astras, the astral weapons, appeared before him. They were neither in this world nor yet in the next. They stood between realms, their bodies of pristine light. The eyes of some were turquoise flames, others had locks of green tongues of fire. Rama said to them, "Dwell in my mind until I have need of you." They melted into him, and he glowed more than ever. You know, I mean, he's a warrior. He defends the kingdom, you know, against Ravana, the evil guy from somewhere else. And so this is a whole nother type of weapon system that is totally alien to us. We can barely even imagine. But we now know, when we have this awareness of the Yugas, you know, of what's going on here. You know, it's like these people have real power, you know, incredible power. Any being like in this Silver Age, and even more there, I mean, there are things that we can't really comprehend, you know. And I sometimes think of like, we have three dogs, and if I go to work as an engineer, they have no idea what I'm doing, you know. They're wonderful animals, but they can't comprehend what I do at Northrop, or they can't understand any of these things. I'm working on computers and things, it's totally beyond them. In the same way, we can't comprehend the kind of work that these people do in these ages, you know. It's really, really different. So the age of the Brahmas Aranyakas, technology of the Silver Age. So I mentioned some of this already. And what's interesting too is that when we go back like to the Egyptian pyramids, what's his name? Michael Dunn, wrote those couple of amazing books. He's a manufacturing engineer that went over to Egypt and started to look at the ancient pyramids, and also some of the Karnak and the other places in ancient Egypt, and began to understand that they had to be based on much more advanced principles. He found the saw marks on the stones of giant saws that cut these, and he found the cavities where the saw was used, you know. But the saw marks are very plain on those stones, because there's a radius, you know. They had to be to make those cuts. And then he noticed about interchangeable parts, like the tolerances on the pyramids, like the Bedford Quarry in Indiana, limestone quarries for our buildings, the tolerances are plus and minus a quarter inch. But the Egyptian pyramids, those stones were a tolerance of plus and minus 10,000ths of an inch. Wow. You know, and why? Why would they need such close tolerances? Obviously, we're doing things with the pyramids that we don't know anymore. Because otherwise, they wouldn't need that. You know, it wouldn't be necessary. And then interchangeable parts, you know, they had these kind of tolerances in ancient Egypt, and it didn't really happen again until before 18th century. Before 18th century, guns were custom made. You broke one, you had to have a gunsmith make you a new one. But the first standardized parts that were, you know, for weapons started in France in 1765 during the transition period by royal order, the Système Gribeauval in France. And so, you know, it's like, this is papyrus beats rock. What the Sphinx are you talking about? Do you even know how it's made? You know, wondering how the pyramids are made. I just thought I'd throw that in. but now let's talk a little bit. I mentioned before the Silver Age with time travel. Remnants of this are tales of fairy circles or ring portals, and people, like, he's trying to keep the guy from going into the ring portal, because there are tales, many fairy tales in different countries, of people stepping into one of these fairy rings and coming out 100 years later or something like that. They were only in there for a short term and were with people, and then they stepped out, and, you know, hundreds of years could have gone by, or 50 years, and, you know, they found their great-grandchildren or something like that. So these tales tell us that there were things like that, and as I mentioned before, that one of the scientists that investigated the stuff with a voltmeter, and he found out that all the stones were magnetically oriented properly, and that they had certain functions for using the geomagnetic energies of the earth to make seeds grow faster, and which is much more advanced than what we do nowadays with artificial fertilizer. And so in the same way here, they used the geomagnetic fields of the earth to create these time warps, I guess, and they must have had some kind of way of doing it that very sophisticated to us, that they could do these rings that would have this kind of effect. But evidently there's, you know, we have these records of it, and we know now that in this that age people could control time. And what's interesting is the Bhrigu Samhita. Kind of learn more about that from Vyasa, from up in Ananda village at CPAC. He told me about it, and Swami Kriyananda had gone to India, had heard about the Bhrigu Samhita, and Bhrigu was one of the ancient rishis who had left behind records of specific things that would happen in the future, and to the point that, like, when Swami Kriyananda went to one of those priests of Bhrigu there in India, they said that they would say, "Oh, your name is such and such, I don't know if they knew his birth date or whatever," but they would go back in the records and they would find the stuff that was recorded about him or anyone else that would come. And it said very specifically that what would happen to him, and then also that his brother would show up. And sure enough, he didn't know where his brother was, but his brother showed up in India exactly when it said. And then also said that he had a sister that was never born. So he asked his mother when he got back to Europe, and she said, yeah, you had, she was pregnant and was stillborn. It didn't, live. And so he had never heard about it. He heard from the Brigu predictions that this would had happened, and so he asked his mother. And so how could Brigu know these things from thousands of years before that this specific thing could happen now? Does that mean everything is exactly foretold in every detail? Everything, there is no free will, you're just stuck? Mm-hmm. No, I thought about this and what it really means. And you have to understand, this is beyond the mind because we're so limited by our mind. But by explaining it, I think you get the idea. What happens is that in God consciousness, there is no time. Everything happens simultaneously. And when you accept that idea, then you understand that Brigu went to this moment of time when Kriyananda came to that hermitage, and what happened right there is happened in that moment in the infinitude of time, boom, there it is. It didn't have anything to do with like prophecy as such and being predetermined or anything. It's just you focus in on this particular moment and that's what happened. And so there were these, these kind of things that where they had control of time and knew where to go and what to do. It's quite amazing. And then in Egypt, they retained the Silver Age magic much longer. Remember Moses and Aaron in the Bible? Moses was trained, and Aaron as well, I guess, because he grew up with the Pharaoh and with the priests, and he was trained in all the Egyptian, magic. And in fact, when remember when he came to the burning bush he meets Yahweh, God, and the first thing he asks Yahweh, what is your name? And because in Egyptian magic, if you know the spirit's name, you can control it. Yahweh said, I am that I am. It's kind of hard to control. And he realized, this was, the ultimate, whatever, the very high being. And so it makes more sense now when we read in the Old Testament with Moses and the magic rods that he wielded, and all these priests, they also wielded it. They had magic wands and things, and so this whole thing was real at the time because they still had a lot of that knowledge from the Silver Age, and this kind of inner technology that they had to look up in the text because they'd forgotten, whereas Moses had gone deep inside and knew the stuff inside out, but the priests had kind of forgotten these things and had to, check on things. And they had these words of power, and so I've told this before because this is such an amazing experience to me, but one of the monks, I had went to see them when I was in college. I was at Occidental College studying, and I was always so busy with all the students around me and hundreds of people in the class and things. And I said, how do I keep my own vibration? And he said, oh, you don't know about the Om Tat Sat? Those are the three highest vibrations in creation. Sat is beyond creation, the Father, and Tat is the Christ, the guiding principle in creation, and Om is the vibration that upholds creation. So when you invoke those three, it forms a cocoon of protection around you. And he said he had been at the beach and he was just resting, and some people with the ghetto blaster came and sat down right nearby him, playing all that heavy metal music. And so he started to intone the Om Tat Sat mentally, And within minutes, the people had gone. It had, like, it, if you're not the right vibration, it hurts, it burns, you know, you want to get away. But then it was surrounded by children and dogs because they love that vibration, you know, because it's uplifting. And then he showed me, it was in his office, you know, at the monastery there, and he started to intone Om Tat Sat, Om Tat Sat. And obviously, you do this from here, you know, from the spiritual eye. And what was strange is all of a sudden, when he's doing this, the room started to fill with power. It started to get more powerful and powerful and powerful. Till finally, it felt that, not just felt, the room was going to literally explode. I mean, it was unbelievable power. I'd never experienced anything like it. And just as it was going to explode, if he had done it one more time, he stopped right then. And oh my gosh, you know, never ever forget that. That's words of power. That's not just saying Om Tat Sat. It's, you know, you fill it with your inner spirit. He knew how to bring it to life. It was back going to the higher ages, that ability, you know. And when you have that, you can create anything at will, you know. And he had gone to a certain level, and you know, and it's helped me a lot. Also, at night, I very rarely have nightmares, but one time I had a nightmare where this I was in like Southeast Asia, and there was this like demonic form in this temple, and he saw me like I was challenging it, and he was coming at me, and I just went Om Tat Sat like that, and all this power came out of me, and it shattered it into a million pieces, and it was such an incredible experience. It was very powerful, you know, and this works, you know. Mm-hmm. So it's a very powerful technique. And I wanted to share the story of the priest Chacha M. Ankh from ancient Egypt. Now, as one of the young women was rowing, she entangled herself in some way in her hair, and one of the ornaments, which was made of new turquoise, fell into the water and sank. She ceased to row, not herself only, but all the other maidens ceased to row also. By the way, this is in the last part of the Silver Age, 3800 BC. Will you not? Okay. And King Neferu saw that the maidens had ceased from their work. He said to them, "Will you not row?" And they replied, "Our leader has ceased to row." Then turning to the maiden who had dropped her ornament overboard, he asked her why she was not rowing, whereupon she told him what had happened. On this, the king promised that he would get back the ornament for her. Then the king commanded that Chacha M. Ankh should appear before him at once. Thereupon the priest and writer of books, Chacha M. Ankh, spake certain words of power, and having thus caused one section of the water of the lake to go up upon the other, he found the ornament lying upon a potsherd, and he took it and gave it to the maiden. Now the water was 12 cubits deep, but when Chacha M. Ankh had lifted up one section of the water onto the other, that portion became 24 cubits deep. The magician again uttered certain words of power, and the water of the lake became as it had been before he had caused one portion of it to go up on the other. And the king prepared a feast for all his royal household, and rewarded Chacha M. Ankh with gifts of every kind. Such is a story of the power possessed by a magician in the time of King Khufu, Cheops, who reigned at the beginning of the 4th dynasty, around 3800 BC, you know, right, kind of still like 700 years from before the end of the downgoing Silver Age. The copy of the story which we possess is older than the period when Moses lived, and thus there can be no possibility of our seeing in it a distorted version of the miracle of the waters of the sea standing like walls, one on the right hand and one on the left. On the other hand, Moses' miracle may well have some connection with that of Chacha M. Ankh. So very interesting. You know, that's when you read it, in once you understand the Yugas, then it starts to sound real because we know what's behind it. It's no longer just some funny fairy tale, you know. And I also think why Egypt never established colonies outside its boundaries is that they would go on raids and plunder the nearby areas, but they always come back. They never conquered and stayed, ever, which is very odd, you know, for, I mean, all the other countries, you know, the ancient peoples, they would conquer and, you know, open up their empires. But I think they knew that the pyramid was designed to amplify that higher energy and keep the age higher in that area in Egypt. And so they always wanted to stay close in Egypt, you know. And then Graham Hancock in The Sign and the Seal, fascinating book, talked about the ark continued to lift itself, its bearers and other objects around it off the ground. It continued to emit light. It continued to be associated with a strange cloud that materialized between the cherubim. It continued to afflict people with ailments like leprosy and tumors, and it continued to kill those who accidentally touched or opened it. So this is higher age technology that was no longer well understood. There's only a few people that understood how to use the Ark of the Covenant. And what's interesting, Graham Hancock talks about that these arks were common in ancient Egypt. They're mentioned in other places, not just in the Bible. So these were things that were left over from the higher age, but already by then people didn't quite know what to do with it. And also, Egyptian court case in 1500 BC, in times of Ramses III, murdered by a woman in harem, appeared as material witness by being channeled in spiritual form. So the person that was murdered was made a material witness and being channeled in spiritual form to tell, yeah, he did it, you know.
Wow.
And this form of evidence was still accepted at that time because the people knew how to use it, you know. So very different from what we do in court today. So then to mention in Satya Yuga, the Golden Age, the fight was between Deva Loka and Asura Loka, two different worlds that were at odds. Like whatever planet you were on, you were okay. You know, it was all beautiful. You know, but there might be another planet or a solar system that's in a low age that's fighting you, or you have to defend yourself, whatever. In the Silver Age, the fight was between Rama and Ravana in the Ramayana, rulers from different countries on the same world. So there's in the Silver Age, you can still have bad people on the same planet. In Dwapara Yuga, the fight was between the Pandavas, the brothers, and the Kauravas in Mahabharata, good and evil within the same family. And then in Kali Yuga, in the Dark Age, the fight is inside of us, our inner battle, to become twice born or born again in spirit, to surrender to God and truly enter this next age. The Bronze Age, Dwapara Yuga. So we're still, you know, we still have that battle inside of us of good and evil that we're fighting. And once we can permanently move into a state of surrender to God and be in that higher consciousness where we always feel that energy inside of us, you know, of God's presence, then that inner battle is, you know, goes away, you know. Not totally, but, you know, it's also we need to learn through conflict still in this age, whereas we get into the higher ages, you don't have to learn through conflict, you can learn through positive things. So from words back to cosmic maintenance, from mental prayer to meditation and stillness, like I had mentioned before, a friend of mine had taught me this, but if I... You know, of course, you know, prayer, words of prayer link you to that higher consciousness. And as we know, words of power, you know, as we learn those things better. But it's not just that. Like here, like I have this tea. If I put my hand over it and then I try to merge, blend my vibration with the vibration of the tea, then it starts to be completely usable for my body. So if you do it in the beginning, you may not feel much, but after a while, you can feel just when the two blend perfectly. It usually takes like 15 to 30 seconds. And it doesn't take long. Some things like lobster might take longer, you know. and the funny thing is that Edgar Cayce was telling a person, oh, don't eat, that's meat, don't eat meat. And the guy says, but I've seen you eat meat. He says, yeah, because I know how to adjust the vibration of that meat to my body so it's usable, you know, mm-hmm. so it doesn't harm me. And so this is the idea of going, this is kind of the beginning of cosmic maintenance. We begin to spiritualize the things around us. And like we have like the prayer for peace that Paramahansa Ananda taught mm-hmm. to send the vibrations of Om throughout the world. And when everybody does that, you know, it's it has an effect on the planet, you know. And so we're beginning to do cosmic maintenance, and we're back into that age. And one of the other things I wanted to mention is this actually came to me in the last year or so, and I did mention it a few months ago. Does the Sirius star system have a habitable planet? What's interesting is that, you know, we've had UFOs, you know, checking up on us periodically. And here, like, some of the pictures and medieval paintings actually show, like, a UFO or craft flying. You know, here's the Virgin Mary, and there's a UFO, you know. And there's a number of these that have been found, and you wonder, like, we've been, you know, they've been watching us, and why? And for one reason is, you know, different parts, different solar systems, different star systems are in different cycles, and so if they're in a higher cycle, they know that we've been in a higher cycle, and we've lost touch with each other, and now they're saying, oh, is it time to go back yet? You know, are they far enough along? Because at this age, you don't really want to, they wouldn't want to deal with us. But I think also what's interesting is that if you think that if Sirius is our binary, I have a sneaking suspicion that they have an inhabited planet around them that we haven't discovered yet. And the thing is, they're about, like, 8.4 light years away or so. So if we're right here, which means that they would be much closer to the Pleiades, of giving out those beneficial influences, you know, that Job talks about. So if we're here, they would be in, you know, down-going golden age right now. And so they wouldn't really be all that interested in us. But the point is that as we get like this and turn to this point, when we're both in Silver Age, one ascending, one descending, we'd both have space travel. We'd both be back and forth. And we would probably, because we're on a related cycle of our binary stars, we would probably go back and forth. And when this starts, like, when we start to go down in this area, more and more of the people living on our planet probably went over here because it's the ascending age. You want your offspring maybe to have a better future, you know? And so, but the people would remember, you know, where back and forth till finally, you know, they stopped visiting us when we get too violent and too low in here. Mm-hmm. But then they'd keep an eye on us, and, you know. And so now as we start to advance, you know, we're going to be back visiting. And, you know, hey, it's been a long time. We're back together, you know, or whatever. But this would also be true to other alien life forms and things that would start to visit us in this area here, you know. So this is about to happen. And now we're kind of living in, I mentioned this before, in the Kali sub-yuga of the Dwapara Bronze Age, which runs from 1900 to 2100 AD. So the end of this century, we would kind of end that darker period of our 2,400 year cycle, and so things will start looking better. So it becomes responsibility now for us to meditate daily and to lift up the planet so that we get to that point that Sri Yukteswar talks about, when we have that quantum leap into that next level to go enter Bhuvar Loka. So that hope, you know, the future kind of lies in us. It's, you know, because we're here listening to this, we're ready to take that step and to help the planet upward. I want to mention that not by works of righteousness are we saved, but by the washing and regeneration of the Holy Spirit. And that's really the Om technique, becoming aware of that divine sound within and merging in that, and that lifts us up, that takes us, you know, to those deeper levels. And this is one of the things that Brother Dharmanand, who passed away a few years ago, he first told me a lot about the Yuga cycle back in the 1970s, and a lot of the things that I learned is from him. And at one point, coming from, you know, being a Lutheran, you know, and then becoming SRF, joining Self-Realization Fellowship, with that Christian background, I asked him, what is sin? And that was such a profound answer that he gave me, because he said, well, for us monks, really, sin means to think of oneself as a physical body, you know. And that was such a profound answer, because that's exactly the kind of thing we're trying to transcend. We, you know, here we were caught in matter consciousness where this body is all that's real, and now we're coming to that twice born with Vija, you know, born again idea of becoming aware of spirit. And so if we start to feel ourselves from meditation more and more, you get that sense of being saturated by that spiritual consciousness from meditation. And it starts to last throughout the day. Sometimes it can go for weeks and months. And there are people who live in it night and day, you know. And that's the whole thing. If we, so for him, the idea of sin was to forget who you really are and just be a physical body. And so once we practice all these techniques, and, you know, we begin to act from a higher perspective. And so many souls were created at the dawn of creation that are still roaming this universe, according to Yogananda. So learn it now or in 1,000 incarnations. How much and how long do we want to suffer? So we want to transcend the yugas. We want to create our own internal paradise that we carry within us, and, you know, get beyond this. So here, this is from Isaiah. All traces of Kali, and this, well, paraphrase from Taramata here. All traces of Kali Yuga civilization shall soon be destroyed. That a world fairer and more righteous than our imagination can picture shall come into being as a fit symbol and manifestation of the ascending Dwapara Yuga, or Bronze Age. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. So, and one of the things I love from The Tempest, from Shakespeare, are... our revels are not ended. These are actors are melted into air, into thin air. And like the basis fabric of this vision, the cloud-capped towers, the gorgeous palaces, the solemn temples shall dissolve, and like this insubstantial pageant faded, leave not a rack behind. We are stuff as dreams are made on, and our little lives are rounded in a sleep. So we see this more and more as we go deeper. And this picture of Swami Sri Yukteswar. And what I really notice is the, when you read Arvabhatta of a Yogi, you know, this is the sage of wisdom, you know, incarnation of wisdom, and yet there's so much love know. And the things he actually does in the autobiography, where he helps people and heals people, you can see the deep love. And there's much more to that that I want to bring out. He says, on transcending the yugas, the holy sound of Om manifests spontaneously through culture of Shraddha, the energetic tendency of the heart's natural love. The culture of this divine love, the heavenly gift, is the principal requirement for the attainment of holy salvation. It is impossible for man to advance a step toward the same without it. And so what I wanted to mention is that I have one last story that I want to share with you. And Brother Bimalananda had a big influence on my life. He was trained by Paramahansa Yogananda as a monk, you know, for years. And then what happened is, when I started this path in 1964, I had a really beautiful experience that started me on the path. And then after that, the monks at Mount Washington, the headquarters, told me, you know, you should really go to our temple in Hollywood. You know, they have Sunday services and things. So I went there, and there was this gardener, you know, picking, you know, weeding the grass and cutting the shrubs and things. And he had these wonderful eyes, you know, just a wonderful person. And so I just talked to this gardener, and he was giving me a lot of, you know, help about, you know, meditation and things. And I found out later that was Brother Bimalananda, you know, who was actually a direct disciple of Paramahansa Yogananda. And he passed away just a few years ago, and he's had a wonderful, you know, effect on my life. And what I wanted to share, you know, I talked just now about the effect of the importance of love. And what I want to leave you with is, I had this wonderful experience. I was talking with Brother Bimalananda, and I was telling him, you know, about, you know, meditating every day and all that. And he says, well, you know, if you really want to make progress on the path, you also need to call on God in the language of your heart. Like, think of him like Paramahansa Yogananda loved God as the mother, the divine mother. You know, in the Catholic Church, you have the Virgin Mary. You know, you have that same concept of love of the mother, you know, of all creation. And because the mother is more forgiving than the father, you know, that kind of concept. And so he told me, you know, just start, you know, do your meditation, but also throughout the day, call on God, you know, call on the Divine Mother, you know. And okay, so I went home and I started doing that every day. And a few weeks later, I went to see him, and I said, you know, brother, I'm doing this all the time, but it's not working. I can't seem to get anywhere. I don't feel anything. And he looked at me and he says, don't you realize that if you're trying this hard, that you must love her a lot already? Mm-hmm. Oh my gosh, you know. If you're trying this hard, you must love her a lot already. And when I went home that night, it was like as if God as the mother just reached down from the infinity and just came down and just embraced my whole being. And it was a love that was so great. I realized I'd never known what happiness was in my whole life until that moment. Yeah, I was like 17 years old, you know, and it's the first time I ever knew what happiness was. There was nothing could compare with that love. It was so overwhelming, so beautiful. You know, the tears were streaming down your face, and I realized, like, I love Saint Francis of Assisi, and I think, you know, how could he ever embrace that leper? That it must have been just really hard, you know. But then I realized, if you have this love, you can do anything. And I realized I'd be willing to suffer, go through any kind of suffering just to feel this love, even for a moment, you know. And so, and that love just kept on going all night, all through the next day. And I went with my parents to Palm Springs, and we had a picnic in the park, and the whole time, my whole being is just singing, and I feel this love coming through me. And And something I would never do, I went over to the swings there, the playground, and played with the kids there. And something I usually never think of doing, you know. And I didn't talk to them, I just helped them on their swings and stuff. And then my parents pulled up in the car and for me to get in to drive home. And I got in the car, all the kids from the playground all stood in a row by the car and waved goodbye to me. And my parents are looking, what's going on, you know? And I realized, you know, it's like as if the Divine Mother is saying, look, my child, I'm telling you, this is not just in your head. My love is real. Look at those children. They felt it. They could feel it, you know? So this is not your imagination. And so, you know, sometimes when we go through our routines of meditation, we forget that it's all for, you know, this love, this personal relationship. And so that's, I wanted to share that story because he would often, like when I would see him when he was still alive at convocation, he would often, you know, he liked the story, you know, he got a kick out of it. And so he would often ask me to tell it to the other people that were there. And that was a real blessing from him. To give, you know, to have that experience. So that's something you can never forget. And I just want to make it aware that love exists, it's real, and it's for all of us. And so here we are at the end.
You are.
And then, there's some of the information, the Binary Research Institute from Walter Cruttenden started, and also CPAC Online, the Conference on Precession and Ancient Knowledge. And there's also, if you go to iTunes and do a search on Cosmic Influence, there are probably 40, 50 interviews by all the people that have done work in this area. And I'm also in one of the interviews. And it's all free. They're all like 45-minute interviews that you can listen to in your car or whatever. So Walter has done a wonderful thing. So I wanted to extend a special thanks to Ananda South Bay for hosting this event, and special thanks to Michael for videotaping, editing, preparing this for YouTube so that this becomes available to everyone. And again, thank you, Walter, for, you know, his inspiration, and also the Monastic Community of Self-Religion Fellowship for all they've done for me, you know, to make this possible. So then there's a little bit of bibliography, and anyway, it's been really wonderful to spend this time with all of you, and we finally did it. Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah.